so I was saying all these years as a designer I avoided division because division hardware is costly. So what did I do? Sometimes you have a division by a fixed number. If you have a division by a fixed number, just multiply with the reciprocal of it, right? It doesn't have to be done as a... So instead of dividing something by 2.3, it's equivalent to multiplying it by 1 over 2.3, right? So if you're doing dealing with fractional numbers, it really doesn't matter whether you divide by a constant or multiply by a constant. But if that's not the case, if you're going to divide two variables, I have one time I had to do it. But what I did was, instead of dividing them, I kept it as a rational number. What's a rational number? Number is if you express a number as A over B, that's a rational number. 3 over 5 is a rational number. But if you... What's that? A and B are integers. Exactly. Very, very good point. So what I did was representing a rational number as a rational number is actually keeping two integers. So I vaguely remember in one design problem, when I needed to divide A by B, I did not divide it. I kept it as A comma B, meaning A divided by B. Then later on, you multiply it with something and compare it with something. Right? For example, let me give you an example. And let me summarize my points. Division is costly. Avoid it if you can. So this is divide by constant. Divide by variable. If dealing with fractional numbers, you may multiply with the reciprocal. Okay. If you're dividing by a variable, if you may, one option is keep it as a rational number. So the other one, I will say any option other than doing a true divide. Let's say I need to do this. And later on, let's say I do if C greater than some constant. Or let's say I do C greater than D. The only place I use this division is here. I can avoid the division. So it's all about actually algebra, right? So this can be transformed to if. So let's do it like this. C greater than D is the same as A over B greater than D, then A greater than B this. So then do if A greater than B times D. I avoided division. I do multiplication. Okay. I mean, this is obviously obvious to most people, but if I have more computations, it may not be obvious. But you can, a lot of times you can still do this. Okay? If you want to avoid it. I mean, when I worked in Silicon Valley, so I worked in Silicon Valley as a designer 7 years. I mean, I was in chip design before, but I was on the EDA side. Maybe I cannot use it as a reference in terms of real design work, but in Silicon Valley, being a designer for 7 years, I have never used division, and I have never seen anyone doing real division. So this computer arithmetic symposium that we went to in Silicon Valley, it was a division paper actually. But it was a divide by constant, but not the fractional problem. So what I want to do today, I want to show you or tell you about that constant division problem we had and our solution. But here I talked about fractional numbers, so I want to discuss fractional numbers. What's fixed point, what's floating point? So whether you're a hardware guy or a software guy, especially if you're working on signal processing designs, you need to know what's fixed point, what's floating point. And again, a lot of people, if they are not really, they don't have much logic design experience in mainstream companies, they'll try to use floating point. But in their case, okay, they have an excuse because they don't want to get into hardware themselves. They have an implementation which is software and which is floating point, and they want us to match 100% their software. Usually, as a logic design guy, you want to do fixed point, you want to match the software, and the software should really come from software people, so they should really do the fixed point version of their original floating point version. And if the guy says, I'm not going to do it, and if he's the boss, if he's the customer, one or the other, then you have no choice but do floating point. Okay? So I'm really not an expert when it comes to floating point. But I will tell you what's fixed point, what's floating point. Fixed point is more or less like integers. But it's really integers that are shifted. that are not aligned, so we'll get into that. Actually, I think that's what I'm going to first talk about in detail, fixed point and floating point, and more floating point than anything else. Then I will talk about our divide by constant problem, but it's not a fractional, it's not a divide by fractional numbers, it's a divide by integers, and we need to know the remainder. So that's not a regular division problem. And I will also mention a few things. I will mention, now describe a fixed point. I will describe floating point. Then I will describe our recent work on division by small constant. With quotient and remainder output. And a few more miscellaneous things. Let me talk about those miscellaneous things and get done with them. I ask there any option other than doing a true divide. What's the other option? So I'm doing a divide by variable. Somehow, for some reason, not for some reason, I mean, eventually, if I'm using that number in a compare, no problem, but somehow, I have to use that division in a complicated formula with no compares, and I have to output the result. So I have to really do the division, but I don't want to use traditional complicated division hardware. So what am I going to do? The kind of thing I can do is something that I can do for other problems also. I mean, it's a sort of Swiss knife of any operation, even divide, even multiplication, even addition, any function f, you can store it as a lookup table, as a truth table, right? As an array. But then it may blow up, right? You're dividing two 16-bit numbers. They are either integer or fixed point. If I do a lookup table and tell me exactly, and I will be generous, and I want the result to be 16 bits, okay, and I want the result to be exact, and I don't want to use any logic than a lookup table, meaning it's like a memory, bless you, ROM, read-only memory. I give the address and the output comes. I'm not going to use any logic to massage the output. Two 16-bit inputs, 16-bit output, how many bits is my read-only memory? How many bits is my lookup table? LUT example. Do a divide by LUT A over B, C, 16, 16, each 16 bit fixed point numbers. How many bits in the RAM? RAM meaning lookup table, same thing. Different names for the same thing. So the total number of inputs is 32 bits. 16 plus 16, 32 bits of input. How many different possibilities do we have? 2 to the 32. So the memory table has 2 to the 32 entries, but each one is 16, which is 2 to the 4. 2 to the 32 times 2 to the 4 is 2 to the 36 bits. If you want to give the amount of memory in terms of bytes, 2 to the 33 bytes, which is 8 megabytes or bits. What did we say? 2 to the 36? No, this is giga. Okay, anyway, 2 to the 36, I'm sorry, bits, which is 64 gigabits. Yes, you can do it, but it's a huge number. So, what do you think you can do? Somehow, yes, go ahead. Too big, right? I mean, this is incredible. It's a huge memory, although it's read-only memory, which is smaller than RAM, which is also writable memory. Still, this will be big. If you could synthesize it with logic gates, you could shrink it down, but it's not going to shrink too much. And if you gave it to a lookup table like this, to a synthesis tool, it will never finish. It will take it 100 years to finish. It will never finish. 1 over B has only one input, and it's 16 bits. Its lookup table is 2 to the 20. It's 1 megabit versus 64 gigabit. It's 64,000 times smaller. It's doable. I mean, it's still big, but it's doable. So, instead, do A times 1 over B. So this is multiplication. And do this. So no need to use lookup table for division directly. You could use multiplication and do the 1 over B with, do this with LUT, which is 2 to the 16 times 16, which is 2 to the 20 bits, which is 1 megabit, 64,000 times smaller. Okay, let's say I want to make it even smaller. Somebody already gave the answer. Who said interpolation? You said interpolation. So let's do it like this. I don't want to start using another board. Okay, hang on. Option one. Don't forget. Option or option one. LUT, LUT. Option 2. MULT plus LUT. Option 3. MULT plus LUT plus interpolation. But the interpolation goes with the LUT. And I'll tell you a little about interpolation. Yes. I see what you're saying. Then you're sort of going for more or less a division algorithm, but you're doing each part of it with a lookup table. So you're recursively, and some people mentioned divide and conquer. So you're dividing the bigger division problem into smaller division problems, and you're doing the smaller divisions with lookup table. So then that one, I could argue that that's definitely a valid solution, but it's like doing almost like a true divide. But then who calls it a true divide? Who calls, I mean, what's the boundary line between a true divide and a not so true divide? So you're right. I mean, yeah, there are many solutions. Very good. Exactly. And actually, that's the solution that I will show you for so that's the divide by constant problem, but dividing an integer with an integer, and you come up with a quotient and remainder. So it's just like what you're describing. We're transforming the bigger divide problem into smaller divides, and we're doing the smaller divides with lookup tables. Small lookup tables. Quite small. So I want to talk about this a little bit. So let me fill this in a few more miscellaneous things. LUTs. Other topics in computer arithmetic. Okay. So this is B, 1 over B versus B, right? And this is how it looks like. What if I did it like this? So although I did not really draw it to the scale, the spacing between these points okay, on the x-axis should be equal to each other. You could do complicated lookup tables where these are not equal, but if they are not equal, maybe they can go logarithmically. They can become logarithmically or maybe exponentially bigger and bigger. So, I mean, there should be a pattern to it. There should be a formula to it. They cannot be arbitrary. Okay? But normally, in a simple lookup table with interpolation, these would be all equal, right? So let's say your original lookup table has 2 to the 16, which is 65,536 entries. 2 to the 16, let's just call it 2 to the 16. In that case, the difference in terms of B's value between those lookup table entries is 1 in the LSP. If it's a fractional number, if it's a fixed point number, it's 1 over something, right? It's 2 to the minus something. What you could do is, you could sort of downsample this lookup table. It's like downsampling an image. So you store lookup table entries every 8. So you have 8 times less lookup table entries. Instead of 65,000, 64,000, you have 8,000. Or you store every 64. You have only 1,000. And you just look to see how much error you make. Like here, for example, it doesn't seem like there's too much error, right? This section, it's almost linear. If it's linear, if you want to find this point in between, it's like the weighted average of these two. If you want to find a point here, it's weighted average by the x-coordinate, right? But maybe around here, over here it's also pretty linear, but maybe in the middle it's not linear. So you have to do some calculation and see how much error this approach introduces. Okay, you can reduce the number of lookup table entries, but in exchange, you have to introduce logic gates, a computation circuit, which is possibly smaller than the amount of lookup table area you're saving. So it's well worth the trade-off. But then, I mean, there's an algorithm. So there is a design problem, but there is also one other drawback if you're doing interpolation. What's the drawback? Lookup table versus lookup table plus interpolation. Emir, you're again in action. So this is better precision. Usually. Okay. And this has possibly less area. This is easier to design. And actually, this has one more benefit. But I mean, this may be the compelling reason why you want to do this, because the kind of lookup table you want to have, if you don't have interpolation, I mean, it's too big for the precision you like. But this has one more advantage, usually. Very good, yeah. Better latency, smaller latency. Critical path is longer. Here, critical path is longer. Okay, anyway, you get the idea of what's interpolation. But this is linear interpolation. You don't have to do linear interpolation. You can do, if you have the background for it, if you have the algorithms, you can find the algorithms from somebody else, but you have to really still be able to understand them. You can do quadratic interpolation. This is all math. Okay? So, if a software guy gave you stuff, he or she said, here's an algorithm in MATLAB. It works very slow. So come up with an efficient hardware for it. Decent area and real time. Maybe this guy inside for a particular function, he used Taylor expansion. Or he used a huge lookup table. So your implementation task is not simply Verilog coding. You should really understand math. Maybe you're going to take his... I mean, I said this is better precision, but this is really... I mean, if you're good at it, you can really come up with a lookup table plus interpolation logic, which has the exact same precision, which maybe even matches the numbers 100%. But it has less area, but will have possibly more latency. More latency. Okay. Like I said, you can do quadratic interpolation you can do, polynomial interpolation degree of n, linear interpolation is polynomial interpolation degree 1, quadratic is degree 2, and so on and so on. Okay? So we discussed lookup tables. I will mention some other topics in computer arithmetic. Write them there. Then I will discuss fixed point. So other topics in computer arithmetic, obviously those other topics are not, or I mean, I have talked about some topics. We discussed some problems in computer arithmetic. I will mention some other problems here, but this is not a complete set. I mean, like any field, the possibilities are almost infinite. Other topics. Like in recent years, there is interest in decimal computation. Decimal computation. Okay. There is an area, really upcoming area, and I'll actually give you applications of these, and I will motivate them. Approximate computing. There is an area called RNS, residue number systems. There is logarithmic, I'm not sure if it's called number systems, but I will call it logarithmic number systems. Obviously, there is floating point. But I will briefly discuss it, floating point arithmetic. And this is actually still one of the hottest areas in computer arithmetic, floating point arithmetic, algorithms and hardware design. And there is cryptographic hardware, but this is such a big area. Computer arithmetic people consider it part of computer arithmetic or partly part of computer arithmetic, but usually a lot of cryptography people think of it as a different area. I mean, this is arithmetic, but it's a whole different domain. It's modular arithmetic, and we're talking about huge exponentials. A to the power of B, A is a 500-bit number, B is a 500-bit number, and so on and so on. Okay? Decimal computation, why there is all of a sudden interest in decimal computation? Maybe some numerical computation problems and humans, scientists have to evaluate the results and they would like to look at decimal results. And precision is really important. And when you convert from decimal to binary, binary to decimal, precision is lost. On CPUs, everything is in binary, but humans enter numbers to programs in decimal. So why do it in binary if programs eventually interact with humans? Because a lot of programs, they take numbers from humans in decimal, in base 10, but then the program does millions of computations on it. Then outputs decimal. So if you do everything in decimal, because it starts with decimal, ends with decimal, you do all those millions of operations in decimal, which is more costly. Doing a multiplication in base 10, the hardware is bigger and slower than binary version. If you do addition, if you do multiplication, if you do any arithmetic operation in base 10 as opposed to base 2, it's more complicated, right? What, integer programming is an optimization problem, has nothing to do with these. Why are you talking about integer programming? Integer programming is a subset of linear programming. Linear programming is something else. You have linear constraints and you have an objective function. You're trying to maximize it. Integer programming is the same problem, but the results can only be integers. So it has nothing to do with this. Okay. So the idea in programming is all those millions of operations, I would rather do them in binary so they will be faster. Okay. But let's say you're making a chip. You take in decimal numbers. And if you do it in binary, you convert it to binary. Let's say you're going to take in two numbers in decimal and you need to multiply them. You can either do a, and let's say you want to do it in a chip because you want it to be ultra fast. You want to take in 200 digit decimal numbers, multiply them, output a 200 digit decimal number. If you do it in binary, you have to convert it to binary, do binary multiplication, convert it back to decimal, and let's say latency is critical. Versus you just do a decimal multiplication, which is more complicated than binary multiplication, but you don't have to do conversion. See what I'm saying? Somehow, I mean, I'm just trying to theorize why people are working on decimal computation hardware more than they used to in the past. I don't know, I'm just guessing. Approximate computing, I have an explanation. Approximate computing is very hot. Recently, for example, in the last few months, I was in Brno, a city in Czech Republic close to Vienna, only two hours and a half from Vienna, right on the border in Czech Republic. They have a very good university, BUT, BUT, Brno University of Technology. One of the best engineering schools in Czech Republic. And there is a professor that he was in Istanbul. I first met him in Prague in January. Then he was in Istanbul in April. Then I met him in June in Brno. The guy, he's both an approximate computing guy and he's also an evolvable hardware guy. You can search the name of this area, evolvable hardware. It's a disjoint area normally from approximate computing, but with evolvable hardware design techniques, he's coming up with efficient approximate computing circuits. What's approximate computing? If you're doing signal processing, not necessarily all the digits has to be correct. Depending on the application, on the signal processing application, you can tolerate varying amounts of precision loss or precision imprecision. Especially in IoT applications, Internet of Things, they talk about they say approximate computing will be useful because they want to trade off precision loss with power consumption. They go, if it's going to consume less power, I can live with loss of precision. Okay? So that's approximate computing. Residue number systems are, we're talking about multiple digit numbers. Let's say it's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, but it's really not 12,345. It's not like first digit is base 1 or not base 1, digit of 1s. Normally, how is it? If it's base n, first digit is n to the 0, right? Second digit is n to the 1, n squared, n to the cube. Residue number systems is like this. Every digit is the result of a mod operation. Like the first digit is mod something of, let's say first digit is mod 7 of the number. Second digit is mod 6. Third digit is mod 15. But they adjust the mods in such a way that when you write a number like that, there is only a single number that corresponds to it in real life. Okay? But the beauty of these numbers are addition, there is no carry chain. You can do it in parallel. Amazing math, but I'm not an expert on it. Logarithmic number systems, the basis, the value of each digit possibly doesn't go like n to the 0, n to the 1, n to n squared, n to the third power, and so on. It goes maybe exponentially or logarithmically. Floating point, I will explain. Cryptographic hardware, I think everybody knows what cryptography is, what computer security is, what encryption is, decryption is. So it has to do with that. And usually the kind of operations they deal with there is modulo arithmetic. So they multiply huge numbers with each other, but they take the modulo of the result with respect to a huge number. Or they exponentiate two large numbers. Again, they take the modulo of the result with respect to a huge number, and so on. One of the most studied design problems here is what's called Montgomery multiplication. I actually met Montgomery first time I attended Computer Arithmetic Symposium in Austin, Texas. The guy is a genius. He's a very famous guy. But what I said again, a fixed point number is really an integer with a fixed decimal point location. By decimal point, I don't mean base 10. It's basically the point. Maybe we could call it the fractional point. So the location of the decimal point is in the head of the designer. It doesn't occupy any bits or any space area in hardware. The parameters of a fixed point number, or what defines a fixed point number, is the number of integer bits and fractional bits. There is also total number of bits, but if you know the number of integer bits and fractional bits, obviously the total number of bits is the sum of the two, right? Some people express or describe fixed point numbers with the total number of bits and fractional number of bits, just like I showed it here. Some people define them or describe them with the number of integer bits, comma fractional number of bits. It's possible to define it with the total number of bits and integer number of bits, but I haven't seen anybody do that. And so fixed point numbers, it doesn't only think hardware designers deal with, it's also software people. There are like class libraries that support, that let you do computation with fixed point numbers. This is true also for MATLAB. I, for example, when I was working at Lucent, wrote a C++ class library, and I defined fixed point C++ template class libraries. There are things called template class libraries in C++. Template meaning they are parameterized, and it exactly fits the use case of fixed point numbers. Before I did this, our DSP engineers were using regular C and calling particular functions. So the original algorithm developer, development guy, was writing regular code with double variables, floating point. If he wanted to multiply numbers, he used star, plus is plus. And since C doesn't support fixed point, nor does C++ directly or in a built-in way, so when they wanted to convert this to fixed point, the fixed point DSP engineer went over the code line by line and had to do this every time the floating point guy released a new version of the code. He commented out the regular C line and made a function call. Lucent. operator overloading. If you want to redesign it, right? So all you do is, the guy writes the floating point code, right? You want to go to fixed point, you can use still star, because in here I'm doing operator overloading. You just have to change the definitions of the variables. You just change the header file. And I was telling him, I wrote a tool, a generator, not exactly a high-level synthesis tool. I will take your C fixed point header file, very quickly design the hardware. I mean, I was doing hardware design iterations in one day. This guy was doing fixed point design iterations in one week. Bonus question. If this was an integer, so question is this. Question. If it had been an integer, unsigned, meaning equivalent of fix 8, 0, its range would have been 0, 2, 2 to the 8 minus 1. However, it is fix this, then what is its range? Okay, go ahead. It's not a quiz, so whoever has the right answer first will get some bonus. Okay, actually it's very easy. Although to a lot of people it's confusing. So the difference between, so this, the pure integer is pure integer, right? Or is it the same as the case where the decimal point is on the very right, right? So this is the integer. Versus fix 8, 5. What's the relationship between these two? The decimal point is moved to the left by 5 points, so, or this is right shifted by 5 digits. Right shifting by 1 digit is dividing by 2. This is dividing by 2 to the 5, 32. So, fix 8, 5 equals fix range wise 8, 0. Two to the five, then range equals this divided by 2 to the 5. Then this is 0 divided by anything is 0. 2 to the 8 divided by 2 to the 5 minus 1 over 2 to the 5. This is equal to 2 to the minus 5. This is equal to 2 to the 3, just like he said. So the way he put it is really complex. Okay, 0 is 0, 2, not 2 to the 8 minus 1, it's 2 to the 3. So it's like this, you find the number of integer bits, 3, fractional bits is 5. So 2 to the integer bits minus 2 to the minus fractional bits. But it really boils down to this. How many digits are there? 8. It goes to 2 to the 8 minus 1 if it was integer. Since the decimal point moved over 5 points, divided by 2 to the 5. So this is what it is. Now I'm going to talk about adding such numbers. Then I'm going to compare and contrast it with floating point. Fixed point, for example, in his previous job, so in the job we met, like I said, he was doing the fixed point algorithm of a physical layer chip. It was a communication chip, Burak. It was for a standard called HPNA 2.0, Home Phone Network Alliance. At the time, Wi-Fi wasn't out. Wi-Fi was almost coming out, but we didn't know how long more it was going to take. Actually, Wi-Fi first came out from Lucent. Lucent bought a Dutch company. It actually came from a Dutch company, but after Lucent bought it, Lucent pushed it, pushed for it to become an IEEE standard. And we knew already Lucent was working on in Netherlands for a Wi-Fi standard and technology so that this would be used on in companies, small offices, homes. But we took it was like 1 or 2 years away. In the meantime, we were working on a technology where people would use it again in companies and homes, especially homes and small offices. Everybody's PC would be hooked up to telephone lines. In homes in the US, even very old homes, every room had a phone jack and had two of them actually. Because a lot of homes had two lines, two phone lines. So anyway, so it was a technology. So Ethernet was a new technology. We didn't have Ethernet. Ethernet requires Cat5 cable. It requires RJ45 connectors, as opposed to regular phones requiring RJ11 and Cat2 cable, I guess. So like I said, in every room you have the jack, phone jack. You just plug it in there. You don't have to. People who network their homes, actually, cables were lying all over the floor, usually, or they were trying to tuck them under the carpet. Anyway, so this would be a transition technology, and regular telephone, it's a baseband signal, there is no modulation. DSL was on a carrier around 1 megahertz, I believe. And our HPNA signal was also modulated. It wasn't a baseband signal. It had a carrier of 7 megahertz. Okay? So on the same phone line, it's radio frequency. Baseband, telephone, voice signal, regular telephone voice signal. Here, DSL. And here, HPNA. But somehow HPNA didn't pick up. Including Lucent, all these companies were late to the market, and wireless came out, Wi-Fi came out early. But anyway, so this guy was working on the chip with me, but he was on the algorithm side. Previously, he was working on cordless phones, and he was writing DSP code using fixed points. So in these cordless phones, handsets, there were processors, little processors, low-end DSP processors. Texas Instruments is good in it, in that domain. And there is no direct hardware support for fixed point, and there is no need. It's really an integer. So if you want to add two fixed point numbers, which have different, if they have the same format, it's just an integer operation. If you're adding two fixed point numbers with different number of fractional bits, you're talking about shift and add for add. Shift and multiples. So if you had to add two different variables, most likely if the algorithm came from him, they were in different formats. And that's what I'm going to discuss next. Let's say I have fix 85A, and let's say I have fix 93B. And I want to add them, and I want to obtain, fix 93B. If I'm doing, I mean, he's writing assembly code, he's calling a shift instruction, then he's calling a add instruction, then he's calling shift again maybe. But then in hardware, I just want to do it with gates in one cycle. So who has an idea about how we're going to do this? No, zero. I mean, not zero, one cycle. Lookup table. Yeah, why not? Why not? Why not? But it would be costly. It would be really costly. And actually, I mean, you use the hardware, but I mean, you have to play a trick. Yeah. If you're shifting by a constant amount in hardware, it's really not a shift. It's an alignment problem. And I'm supposed to come up with, so, this is where the decimal point is here, but this is where the decimal point is here, and you have to line them up. It's all about lining up the decimal points. I mean, the LSB of this guy, if they were regular integers, the LSB of B and the LSB of least significant bit of A are worth the same amount of value. And you can line them up, so they can be lined up based on their LSBs. But here, their LSBs are not the same digit. Their decimal points are the same location. So you have to line up their decimal points. And the answer is, so these are supposed to be zero anyway. I mean, this may be non-zero. Anything can be done in one cycle. Any crazy algorithm. Any crazy algorithm can be done in one cycle, except I mean, state machine by even state machines can be done in one cycle. But if you have to store something in a memory, and you need to be able to time your hardware, find the critical path for a memory not to complicate your, or not to make your critical path calculations impossible, it has to have flip-flops. Then you cannot do it in one cycle. Unless you have memory in your design, memory array, block RAM, right? Then it can be done, everything can be done in one cycle. But you have to do unroll loops, loop unrolling. Systems with memory, like state machines, can be so what is a system with a memory? If you have memory, it's like you have some sort of at least implicit loop, and you cannot always unroll loops. You cannot unroll loops which iterate for an unknown number of times. In that case, you pick a maximum number, you unroll for that maximum number, and so on and so on. So pretty much anything can be done in one cycle, but that cycle can be very long. And the resulting hardware can be huge. So normally if you're adding these numbers, you will have a bit here, but you don't need that. So you will truncate these. So you can forget about these. Although you don't need this bit, this may give a carry. So you cannot eliminate these two. So this is an example in which there are many interesting issues. So I have a bit here which is destined to be zero. If somebody wants it, I can simply output a zero there, right? So what am I doing? If you're going to use 3, 6, 9, you can use a 9-bit adder. So you can use an adder like this. Or you could simply, basically it's a 9-bit addition, but some of the bits are 0 here, right? 9, 10 bits. So this is not 8, this is 9. Okay? But if you logic synthesize it, the logic synthesis, it will take advantage of these being 0 and optimize the number of gates and timing for you. Okay? But actually, I want to discuss something more interesting. Let's discuss the case where these numbers are not unsigned, they are signed, meaning 2's complement. Let's try this case. Again, this. Okay. Now I will write it like A7, A6, A5, A4, A3, A2, A1, A0, B0, B1, B2, B3, B4, B5, B6, B7, B8, 0 to 8. Okay, one more bit. And remember, these are 2's complement, so if I have a 1 here, it means minus 1. This is also minus. So in these bit positions, I have either 0 or 1, but in this bit position, I have either 0 or minus 1. But electrically, circuit-wise, I have 0 or 1, if you know what I'm talking about. I have 0 or 1, but the 1 means minus 1. Okay? C, and C. 2, 5, and C. 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, 0. And let's put the decimal points back in right here, right here. Right here. Okay. Who's going to tell me if I can say for this one 0? No? Okay. What's the right answer? This is still a sort of trivial redundant bit. They call it redundancy. Redundant, sort of unnecessary. This is equal to C8. Because why? Since this is a 2's complement number, this is the sign bit. This is the sign bit. This not being necessary means it's actually the same as this. I mean, if I didn't have this, it would be still correct. Meaning, C8 would be the sign bit. This version and the one with no C9, to be equivalent, C9 has to be equal to C8. Okay? What else? So how am I going to add these two numbers? I cannot simply, here, I simply use regular addition. I mean, whatever digits I don't have here, I put zeros. What am I going to do? Okay, let's. So this is like this. Yeah, he's also a genius. A7. No, we need it. But then we don't need it to, we don't need to extend one more time if we say C9 will be the same as C8. So this is what I'm going to do. So ignore these guys. And instead of 9-bit addition, I'm going to do a 10-bit addition. And this is a 9-bit addition, but it's going to take fewer gates than a 9-bit addition because these are zeros, hardwired to zero. But those inputs in this case are not hardwired to zero. They are hardwired to variable values, variable signals, right? So this is bigger. But can I optimize it? I actually showed you signed addition, and I showed you a pretty optimal signed addition using the same trick. This can be optimized so that it's pretty close to the hardware complexity of that guy. Okay. So anybody who remembers the kind of tricks I played with multiplication? And although this is something so simple, this trick I'm going to show you, I'm not sure if anybody showed it anywhere in a book or paper, but possibly not that they don't know. I'm pretty sure it's practiced in the industry, and for academicians, they think it's such a minor point, it's not worth writing or publishing anywhere. So I get rid of these. Actually, come to think about it, I'm not sure in this particular example it will be smaller or faster, but this is an alternative, and in some cases this may be a smaller and faster circuit. You remember this trick? No, no. I talked about boot multiplication after I showed this trick. This is a sign multiplication trick. In sign multiplication, so I had this notation, right? In a 2's complement number, only the leftmost bit, for example, is a negative, a signed bit. All the rest are regular bits. But to really add two 2's complement numbers, they have to be the equal. They have to be equal number of bits. Their MSBs should be signed, right? With this notation, I can treat any bit as signed. In this case, this is signed and this is signed. Instead of sign extending them, I make these positive. Remember, I had this. I had a formula like this. A digit, a bit A, which is negative, meaning either 0 or minus 1, is equal to minus 1, a fixed constant minus 1, plus A bar. So if A is 0, minus 0 is 0, right? It's equal to minus 1 plus A bar. 0 bar is 1. So if A is 0, it's equal to minus 1 plus 1. If A is 1, this is actually minus 1. So this is minus 1. 1's complement is 0 plus 0. So instead of this negative bit, I make it a regular bit, positive bit, by negating it, complementing it, and I put a minus 1 here. I do the same thing for this guy. Now I wanna, this is an unsigned number, or if it is a signed bit, it's guaranteed to be 0. And this is, if you treat this as a 2's complement number, its sign bit is 0. And this number is a 2's complement number guaranteed to be negative. Initially, I write it like this. This is a minus 1 in this position, a minus 1 in this position. If you take this position as reference, this is minus 9. But I have to write it so that its MSB is minus 1. So this is like, assume this is digit of 1. This is minus 1, this is minus 8, this is minus 9. On the other hand, this is minus 16 plus 4 plus 2 plus 1, which is also minus 9. Now I have three numbers that are 2's complements because their sign bits are the leftmost. You can just add these. Instead of adding three numbers, you could just do compression, then addition, but it's a smaller addition. And you don't even have to do compression here since these are constants. Maybe you could play tricks, but possibly you will have to do compression. But that compression will not really take much hardware because I don't have, I already have two numbers here, no compression needed. Two, 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 two. Here, here, I need a full adder, but it's a full adder with one input hardwired to one. So the full adder here is going to be a smaller full adder. Here, I have only two bits. Here, I have two bits. Here, I even have two bits. Oh, actually, let's see. Yeah, there is a carry, so I will need a cell here. I will need a cell here. I think that's it. In three positions, I will need a cell, but they are going to be much smaller than a full adder. Then I will have an adder. This will be possibly smaller and faster than the other guy. But you may say, who cares if you're going to save 100 picoseconds and if you're going to save a few gates? Yes, nobody cares if you're going to save a few gates. But everybody cares under certain circumstances if you're going to save 100 picoseconds. Because if I'm missing my timing, let's say I'm going to interface to PCI Express. PCI Express is running at 266 megahertz, which is like 3.8 nanoseconds. And I'm missing it by 100 picoseconds. Doesn't matter if I'm missing it by 100 picoseconds or 1 nanosecond, I'm missing it. And let's say for days I've been trying to meet timing and I could not meet timing. And this trick will make me meet timing. That's it. If you need to meet your timing, and if you're not meeting it by 100 picoseconds, everybody cares about 100 picoseconds. Okay? So these tricks are valuable. And I was going to describe you floating points. Okay, I did not discuss the range of sign numbers. Again, obviously, 2's complement. And I did not discuss the range of fixed point sign numbers, 2's complement numbers. But I'm pretty sure you can do it, and that may be an exam problem, for example. Actually, a lot of these tricks are applicable in software also. I mean, we're really discussing here arithmetic. Without an algorithm, you cannot speak of hardware. So if you take the area discussion here and timing discussion, but then there are equivalents of it in software. But at least the arithmetic tricks exist if you're going to do these in software. The area discussion is equivalent in software. The algorithmic complexity, the total number of operations. The timing that we discuss is not directly applicable to software because the number of operations, which is proportional to the area of the hardware version, is also represents the timing complexity. In software, if you do it on a regular processor. But if you're doing it on parallel hardware, then the timing discussion there would be similar to the timing discussion of hardware, although not exactly. Okay, floating point, the decimal point, is not at a fixed location. Is not at a fixed location. And it varies. Hence, should be kept in a on a wire or in a flop in a register, but I'm not talking about Verilog reg type, I'm talking about the real hardware register if need be in a register. The decimal point is like a pointer. Point is like a, the location of the decimal point, the location of like a pointer. So let's say the decimal point is here. So how many bits can the exponent be? Assuming that the regular value part is what it's called mantissa. If it's 8 bits, what could be the exponent? Exponent shows the location of the decimal point. One answer, some people would say it would be 3 bits, because it could be at 0 or 1 or look at it like this. This is bit 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. So one could say it could be either here or here or here or here. There are 8 different possibilities, so maybe 3 bits for the exponent. The decimal point could be here, yes, could be here, 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 could be here. That's 8. Could also be here, that's 9. Could even be here, could even be here. Having the decimal point here means this is actually 0.00000, then some numbers. Having the decimal point here, this means if this is, for example, 255, it's really not 255, it's 255 times 2 to the power of such and such. So how many bits? We cannot tell. It depends on your dynamic range. So the exponent can even be a negative number. If it's here, it's like this integer times 2 to the minus something, right? So can even be a negative number. This actually brings a point in terms of fixed point numbers, we could also have interesting cases. Such as fix 8 minus 3, fix 8, 13. Who's going to come and show me what these are? Let's not spend time. This is like this. So I have a total of 8 bits. If it was 8 comma plus 3, the decimal point would be here, right? So, and if it was here, 4. So minus means it's over here. So this is like, it's an 11-bit number, but the rightmost, and it's an integer. Since this is not plus. And this one is this. Like here it would be zero. If you go like this, this number is plus. So minus means it goes like this. And these locations are empty. If these locations are empty, it means it's zero. 13 is, so this is zero. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. We'll go over 6 more locations. So this is this. Okay? Let's go back to floating point. Why, if people use fixed point most of the time, at least chip designers, why use floating point? If you're talking about very large numbers, at least value-wise, it can reach billions maybe, right? And let's say if you represent something with fixed point, if you have an algorithm, for example, an adaptive signal processing algorithm and so on, it computes anyway, any algorithm, any iterative algorithm. The value you iteratively compute may become zero and may get stuck there. And some algorithms, zero is like a black hole. If you get into the black hole, you vanish. You're done. You don't exist anymore. In a lot of mathematical algorithms, the difference in meaning between zero and non-zero is infinite, right? 1/0 is infinite, but 1/non-zero is not infinite, right? And also, there are algorithms where, like I said, something gets smaller and smaller, very infinitesimal, but normally should not become zero, and may recover from being very near zero. But if it gets stuck in zero, it's stuck. In algorithms like that, you have to use floating point. And that's sort of a what they call dynamic range problem. With fixed point, given enough number of bits, right? We have an exact representation, right? No, even with floating point, if we have a more flexible representation of floating point, I mean, you could add 232-bit floating point numbers. If you want to represent the result as a 32-bit floating point number, there is no exact representation. You're doing some truncation. But if you have the definition of an n-bit, n comma m, n-bit mantissa, n-bit exponent, if you have a more flexible definition of floating point, then you can represent the result with no loss of information. And interestingly, floating point, in floating point, multiplication is a less expensive operation than addition. Because in multiplication, you multiply the mantissas and you add the exponents and that's it, you're done. In addition, you have to align them, you have to add them, you have to renormalize them and so on and so on. Interestingly, again and again, addition is a more complicated operation than multiplication in floating point. In computer arithmetic field and research community, a lot of people work on floating point.